Good morning. We welcome all of you to worship on this first Sunday in Lent. We're glad that you have joined us, and we want to welcome those who are with us on Zoom.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship. I will read the light print, if you could read the bolded print. The first shall be last.
We come to worship with confidence.
The last shall be first.
We come to worship with doubts.
The first shall be last.
We come with questions.
The last shall be first.
We come burdened by failure.
The first shall be last.
We come celebrating success.
The last shall be first.
We come fearful of the future.
The first shall be last, and the last shall be first, and a little child shall lead them. Let us pray. Father God, thank you that we are able to gather here today and worship you. Thank you for all you've provided for us, and help us to prepare our hearts and minds to hear your word and voice. You humble our hearts and show us that your grace is enough. Amen. Our opening hymn is Great is Thy Faithfulness, which is 43 in the Blue Hymnal.
Thank you.
Let us greet one another in Christ's name. Our next hymn is God is Here Today. It's number 2049 in the black hymnal. You can stand if you'd like.
The season of Lent is especially a time for reflection, for confession of sin, and we'll include a prayer of confession or a similar prayer each week through the season of Lent in our worship. So I invite you to join in unison this morning in a prayer for Lent. We pray, O God, that this might be for us a season of turning around. Of both turning from self-centeredness and small-mindedness and destructive habits, and of turning toward you. Through these 40 days of Lent, help us to follow you and to find you in the discipline of praying, in the gift of learning, and in the hard work of caring. Help us to discover you in our loneliness and in community, in our emptiness and our fulfillment, in our sadness and our laughter. Help us to find you when we ourselves are lost. Help us to perceive new growth amid the ashes of the old. Help us carrying your cross to be signs of your kingdom.
Our scripture reading today is Mark chapter 9, verses 30 through 37. It's in the New Testament on page 45. They went on from there and passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and a servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them. And taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me."
The Daytona 500 is the iconic NASCAR race. It's the opening race of the season, and it's held this afternoon. I'm not really an auto racing fan, but I want to tell you about the 1979 Daytona 500. That year, the race was televised for the very first time. And going into the final lap, Donnie Allison was in the lead with Cale Yarborough close behind. As Yarborough tried to pass, Allison kind of drifted toward the inside, forcing Cale Yarborough into the grass. Well, incredibly, Yarborough kept control of his car. He got back on the track. He caught up to Allison. This is all in the last lap. And the two tangled on the backstretch. Yarborough eventually forced Allison into the wall, and the two cars crashed. Richard Petty, who was back in third place, cruised past both cars and won the race, earning a then-record $73,900. But at that point, the TV cameras turned back to the site of this crash, and viewers saw a heated argument between Cale Yarborough, Donnie Allison, and his brother, Bobby Allison, and finally a fist fight broke out right on the track while people watched on national television, no doubt spurring the growth of NASCAR into what it is today. Well, while the front runners were fighting and arguing on live television, important things were happening. While they were arguing, Richard Petty won the race. Well, that same scene is replayed over and over in all kinds of venues, not only in sports. In fact, we have a variation on this in our scripture reading from Mark. Jesus and the disciples are traveling through Capernaum, traveling through Galilee. They're on their way to Capernaum. And Jesus is sharing some deeply personal and very important things with them. Jesus is speaking of his own death. But his disciples didn't understand what he was saying. They were afraid to ask. It appears some were not really listening very closely anyway. Jesus could hear heated words among his disciples, but couldn't quite make out what they were saying. And if Jesus couldn't hear him, chances are they couldn't hear Jesus. And so when they reached Capernaum, Jesus asked what they were arguing about along the way. The scripture says they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. The disciples had missed Jesus' words while they were arguing about who was the greatest. And that begs the question, what do we miss concerning God's kingdom? Because we are busy arguing about something else. We live in a very argumentative age. How often do important matters get left behind while we argue? We see it in political life as there's argument and political grandstanding, sometimes over relatively minor matters, while the more important issues of the day get left behind. I know of a church that had a big argument over the color of the new carpeting going in the sanctuary. One man got so mad, he left the church over it. So the focus wasn't on spiritual growth, it wasn't on loving one's neighbor. For this person, the focus was on getting your own way. Social media is kind of a laboratory and a training ground for endless argument. It doesn't really mean what the topic is. If you put any kind of opinion out there, folks are going to argue with you, and the name calling will start almost immediately. I mean, what could be a forum for conversation and understanding devolves into a hate fest, and that kind of spirit seeps its way into all kinds of areas of life. Of course, this can happen in families. How often do families squabble over matters that in the end don't really matter that much, while more important concerns are unaddressed? Now, disagreement can be a good and a healthy thing. It's important to have honest discussion. It's important to face hard issues. But when Jesus had a disagreement, when he had an argument with someone, it was almost always about the lack of regard for the needs of people. The disciples, on the other hand, are entirely self-serving. They're arguing among themselves about who is number one. It's all about them. In Jesus' time, life was all about hierarchies. Somebody had to be top dog. There were national hierarchies. You had the Romans and then the conquered nations, the vassal states. Greeks kind of looked down on everyone else, as those with culture might look down on hicks from the sticks. There were religious hierarchies. We read about the Pharisees and the Sadducees, but there were numerous religious groups, each with their own religious and social standing. Of course, there were economic hierarchies. There were rich absentee landlords. There were landed managers who ran their estates. And then there were poor day laborers who just eked out a meager existence. And below them were slaves. There were all kinds of hierarchies. And the disciples, they're just trying to establish their own. Who is the greatest? It's hard to be real tough on the disciples here because we're actually a lot like them. Iowa State might lose other games, but you want to beat the Hawkeyes, right? So that you'll have bragging rights. And folks in Iowa City feel the same way about the Cyclones. We all want to be at the top of the hierarchy. A lot of effort goes into determining who is the greatest. There's the Grammys, the Oscars, the Golden Globes, the People's Choice Awards. Band and orchestra members, they don't really aspire to be third chair, right? You want to be first chair. Girl Scouts can battle over who sells the most cookies. I don't want to even get started about middle school and high school hierarchies, who's the in-group and who's not. It goes on and on. I mean, how many people try to outdo their neighbors with Christmas lights? There are plenty of hierarchies in the world, and there can be religious hierarchies. I don't hear it much in American Baptist circles, but I have been asked, how big is your church? The disciples, believing that Jesus' kingdom was imminent, were arguing over who was going to get to be vice Messiah. In all their discussion about who was the greatest, they didn't hear what Jesus was saying. He was speaking about his own suffering and death and resurrection, but they missed it. Jesus seemed to have an inkling as to what they were talking about. I have a feeling maybe they'd been through this routine before. And he said, whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all. And then Jesus took a child in his arms and said, whoever welcomes a child in my name welcomes me. Today, family life often revolves around children. You know, the calendar can revolve around taking kids to ball games and dance lessons and various school activities. Grandparents dote on grandchildren. But this pattern really only emerged in recent times. It wasn't the case in Jesus' day. Children were considered to be almost without value. They were to be neither seen nor heard, especially in a gathering of men. Children had no status. Their value only came when they were old enough to contribute something to the family. For a public figure like Jesus to take a child and hold the child in his arms while teaching would have been truly shocking. And his point cannot be missed. The disciples argued over who was the greatest, but Jesus is redefining greatness. Greatness was seen in welcoming the least of these. We're to care for the least of these. We're to serve with humility, valuing everyone, welcoming everyone. In Jesus' eyes, every person has great worth. Christian life is not about striving to be number one. It is about service, and it requires humility, which is not putting yourself down, but lifting others up and valuing each person. This is not easy. It doesn't come naturally for a lot of us. Henry Nouwen wrote, "From the beginning of my life, two voices have been speaking to me. One saying, 'Henry, be sure you make it on your own. Be sure you become an independent person. Be sure I can be proud of you.' And another voice saying, 'Henry, whatever you're going to do, even if you don't do anything very interesting in the eyes of the world, be sure you stay close to the heart of Jesus. Be sure you stay close to the love of God.'" We are in a season about reflecting on what it means to follow Jesus, about what it means to stay close to the love of God. A man recalled being in Coast Guard boot camp. The day came to go to the firing range to learn to shoot. The man had never handled a firearm. He really didn't have any interest in it, but he signed up for the service, so he didn't have any choice. And most of his fellow recruits bragged about what great marksmen they were. There was going to be a big competition over who was the best. Well, needless to say, this man, who was a complete novice, would not be anywhere near the same league as these self-proclaimed experts. But when all was said and done, although he wasn't quite the best in the class, he was pretty close. He'd done better than most, including those who thought they were so great. Well, after they were done, the shooting instructor pulled this man aside. He said, "I can tell that you've never shot before." Well, the recruit asked how he knew that. He said, "Because you had no bad habits to overcome and no ego to overcome. You were open and ready to learn, and that's why you were able to do so well." The disciples, with their egos and arrogance and concern was for who was the best and who was right and who was number one, they were not open and receptive to what Jesus had to offer. The same spirit that would welcome a child would welcome Jesus. And to truly welcome a child means to value a child, to listen to that child, to begin to discover imagination and wonder and adventure and a new way of looking at life. How much do we need a sense of imagination? How much do we need to be able to see the world in a different way? How much do we need to experience a life of faith as an adventure? A little child really doesn't care about someone's race or background or occupation or educational level. How much do we have to learn from children? True greatness involves humility. It involves valuing and caring for all of God's children, which means being able to learn from all of God's children. I came across a word of welcome from a church bulletin. This was some years back. I may have shared it before, but it's worth saying again. This wasn't your usual bulletin blurb. And actually, we don't have enough room in our bulletin for a blurb of this size, but this is what they put. It read, "We extend a special welcome to those who are single, married, divorced, gay, trans, filthy rich, dirt poor, yo no habla ingles. We extend a special welcome to those who are crying newborns, skinny as a rail, or could afford to lose a few pounds. We welcome you if you can sing like Andrea Bocelli, or if you can't carry a note in a bucket. You're welcome if you're just browsing, just woke up, or just got out of jail. We don't care if you haven't been to church since little Joey's baptism. We extend a special welcome to those who are over 60 but not grown up yet, and to teenagers who are growing up too fast. We welcome soccer moms, NASCAR dads, starving artists, tree huggers, latte sippers, vegetarians, and junk food eaters. We welcome you if you're having problems, or if you're down in the dumps, or if you don't like organized religion. We've been there too. If you blew all your offering money at the dog track, you're welcome here. We offer a special welcome for those who think that the earth is flat, work too hard, don't work, can't spell, or because grandma is in town and wanted to go to church. We offer a special welcome for those who could use a prayer right now, had religion shoved down your throat as a kid, or got lost in traffic and wound up here by mistake. We welcome tourists, seekers, and doubters, and you. To welcome and to value all people in that way, and in humility serve God and others, for Jesus, that is true greatness. Rachel Held Evans was a wonderfully authentic writer and speaker who died tragically a few years ago at age 37. And her writing is just filled with humility. In Searching for Sunday, she wrote, "It's the oldest religious shortcut in the book. The easiest way to make oneself righteous is to make someone else a sinner." But that doesn't work. We are all sinners, and God welcomes each and every one of us. We are called to be the kind of community that welcomes a child, that welcomes those who might appear to have little to offer. And Jesus says that to welcome a child in his name is to welcome him. Amen. Well, I'll lead us as we pray together and then ask you to join in as we pray the Lord's Prayer. We come before you this morning, dear God, with gratitude for your love and your care for each of us. We praise you that we don't have to earn your love. We don't have to rise to a certain level of goodness. There's nothing we can do to make you love us more, and there's nothing we can do to make you love us less. You love us simply because we are your children. And yet for some reason, we want to treat some of your children as if they are less. We can put others down so that we will somehow look better. We can strive for greatness, thinking it's all about us. But you redefine greatness, dear God. Jesus said greatness was found in servanthood. And so we would pray that you would give us more compassionate hearts and more attentive spirits, that we might truly care for one another, and especially for the least among us. Help us to be a church where all are welcomed and valued. And lead us all to examine our own hearts and to reflect on how much we are taken in by the world's definition of greatness, and how much we are trying to follow Jesus' example of greatness. Lord, we lift up before you this morning concerns we have shared. We pray for mercy, Israel. Surround her with your love and your presence. We pray for healing, and we pray for access to treatment. Lord, we lift up Emma. We're thankful that she had a good doctor's appointment in Cincinnati. Continue to lift her up. We pray for Lily. We're thankful she's doing better, but pray you continue to be with her and her family. We lift up Bruce Whitaker. We pray for healing. We pray for his family. We pray for the medical personnel that were working with him. Lord, we are thankful for all the ways that you work in our lives, all the people who have had humility enough to care for us and teach us and lift us up. And we pray that we would be able to follow in the way of Jesus, who taught us to pray, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We invite you now to stand if you would like as we sing our closing hymn. It's the Servant Song, found on 2222 in your black hymnal. Whatever wilderness the Spirit has brought you to, walk in boldness as a beloved child of God. Walk in peace under the shelter of the Most High, and walk in faith, knowing that Christ walks with you. Amen.